Everybody here?
I've got a question for Eric and Dorita. I've used the R drive for e-reserves that need special clearance for copyright and things. Are we able to use the same approach that we do in getting you all to put something on e-reserve on the R drive on here?
We are not to this yet. E-reserves will stay on R drive for next year.
For the next year?
Yeah, because we've got to have time to study it. I have to figure out where it's got to go here and how we have to do it here. I haven't done that here.
We won't lose it until at least next fall.
My Westminster. I can get into the R drives, and I have folders that are designated for us to put their e-reserves on there. I don't know yet how, and that's, so e-reserves are still going to stay on R this fall.
Okay, I understand the sense of the group, and I'd like you to correct me when my sense is incorrect. That we will continue to do, I need to be on tape for this, so that we continue to provide the technology instruction in the area of GroupWise, the drive structure of the college, meaning N and R drive, and that we will instruct our students relative to the existence of Mr. EDU, show them how they might sign on, and to whatever degree we as individual faculty members choose to use it, we will do so. That's what I understand the consensus of the group to be. Is that a fair reading? And comment?
Question. You have a fair reading. I thought that was a fair reading.
Is that others? Fair reading as to where you want to be, and as that I may communicate to the deans as your suggested approach or determined approach.
My question then is, I'm going to go back to John Robertson's comment, which is everybody here going to use My Westminster for their inquiry class to some extent? Because it's...
In a sense, it is a parallel with the ghost map.
Yeah.
It will be an element of the course. The extent to which it will exist within any course will be a function of the particular instructor.
Excellent. Okay.
And then I would just add that I look forward to the fact of development that can happen as part of this group. So I would hope to use it in increasingly interesting ways as the semester goes on, as I learn from others how they're doing it. So the minimal commitment, I think, is important because we can provide that.
Maybe we'll just have a series of Jack Teaches Us LMS lunches. One second while I add to my external storage device. That was a legal pass.
Experience, but would you try to work with your other little kids, the students you've had in multiple classes, know you a little bit more
supposed to be a tool to help you teach.
One sort of tangential question that occurred from a student perspective, if suddenly a lot of things are available to them electronically, they have to print them, that comes out of their printing budget, which isn't going to change, right? They get 300 pages, is it?
There's
always. So right. Might we not expect complaints about that if they're having to print more things on their own dime?
That's all I've heard about. I hardly ever give
you don't
them get paper.
Notes
I'm
us.
Very seldom.
Okay. And you haven't heard of
yeah.
They don't print it out.
The problem is that they don't have any cables. It's ridiculous.
They won't print stuff out, and they'll claim that the printer was down.
Okay, so I will write this up in the coming hours. We will review it tomorrow to make sure again that I have the sense of the group. I was more concerned rather than the content of the policy as to what that approach would be. Reach consensus on that, at least again, 5 cents. Okay, since you are tired of hearing me stand up in front, I'm gonna turn things over to Dr. A for a few minutes. With that, if that's acceptable.
Not even a few.
Please. Drag on for a little bit.
September, first week of September last year, the New York Times had asked major figures in academia across the country to write one suggested thing they would tell incoming first-year students as recommended wisdom. And they printed like 10 of them. And I put 7 of them on a handout. This is not being put forth as something to consider for the handbook, for the reader, rather. But I thought you'd be interested to see what, like the historian Gary Wills, Harold Bloom, the government professor James McGregor Burns, what they would say as their one piece of advice. And some of it's humorous, but I thought it was very, very nicely to the point. So it's just a handout for you guys to take a look at. They may do it again this fall, but this is what they were telling the class of 2013. You may want to hand it out to your students. You may just want to leave it and read it yourself. See, I'm very big on handing them words of wisdom things and tips on how to get through school. And I would like the confirmation that this had coincided with a lot of the things that I tell them anyway. But they come from different disciplines. And it was a nice kickoff to the year last year.
You know when I stopped doing that?
Stanley Fish.
You know when I stopped doing that?
Especially Don't Alienate Your Professor. Read that one.
Oh, that's awesome.
Which is shape up, you know. It's, you know, the dealing with the student who shows up in his pajamas and basically is in a semi-recumbent position in the whole class and basically looks at you as 3D television.
That's a short version.
Things
like whatever, the night thing or the about. Right attitudes for learning, that's what it
right.
is. It's the same thing.
Okay.
For sure.
That's all that's my daughter, the French kiss.
Why?
What was the response, Andrew?
After the eyebrow.
Well, because he was new to them, they were looking at it like, oh, they were thinking about it more than immediately agreeing or, you know, it's how they act whenever anyone who's older suggests something that they hadn't thought about and doesn't, you know, they need time to have it sink in. So it went well. It's just that it took them the semester to really absorb it. And as one of the things was to the off-campus life, it says try to read a good newspaper every day. The only thing I ask my inquiry students to buy outside of the reader is a subscription to the New York Times available down in the bookstore. And so I have them pick it up every morning. I ask them to read 3 articles every day. And we come to discuss in class a couple of them. If a major person dies, I want them to read that obituary. I want them to read the sports page. I want them to read the financial page. Some of them never really read the newspaper. And before they die, not the students, but the newspaper. Before newspapers die, I would like them to know what a newspaper was. It seems to be on its way out.
So did you? You had these 7 articles. Did you bring them up over the course of this term, or did you present it once and sort of forget about it, or did you continue to refer to them?
I brought this up once and then referred to them. And then I also had my own list of weekly wisdom that I gave every week.
And would you like to post that to the V Drive?
Those of you who know me. Now that I do this, I then give them a laminated version of the weekly wisdom at the end of the semester, which is every week I made sure that there was 1 a week. And then I give this to them to put up all their rooms. I want to see this in your rooms. Next semester, I don't want to learn that you threw away my weekly wisdom.
Well, I have a glued to their board.
College is not high school.
Yeah, true, but
the same issue.
Yeah. 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 Good. The last one is don't do anything stupid.
Don't do anything stupid. That's too late. The best thing of all.
I like this. Don't write or say anything stupid in your work. Don't plagiarize. Don't get too drunk, and certainly don't drive. Don't take advantage of a vulnerable person. Don't go back on your word. Be silly and entertaining, just not stupid. That's last week.
Okay.
Thank you, Andrew.
Mr. McDonald is passing out the 2 additional readings that were suggested earlier for which we did not have paper copies. That would be Marquez?
Garcia Marquez.
Gabriel Garcia Marquez. And
day 1 of the
Dr. Rohr.
Dr. Rohr. 5.
Son of former President
Will Orr.
This has been a very useful, I think, discussion of the LMS and how we want to approach it. So I'm sort of it reappears again on the agenda tomorrow, so it will be scratched because I can't be able to come to. Yes, I think we're done with that. And I'll probably reissue the agenda a little bit tomorrow and make some adjustments. But because of the hour, we won't be breaking out in the sense of. Going into small groups. So let's look at a couple of smaller things that I think we can resolve before 3:30 today. One of those is in that list, inculcating appropriate lecture etiquette. This was an item that is of some concern. In fact, it was mentioned earlier today, etiquette generally. It had been a topic of luncheon discussion. Well, it had been on the agenda for luncheon discussion all last fall and never really was finally resolved as to what we should do. It comes out of concerns during lectures by prominent folks, Steingravers, not John Firelane, here he goes. Scott Momaday, especially Crable, among others. Oh, they were pretty well behaved. Ross had
had shared with us sometime in the fall a description of something he had shared with his students prior to the lecture. We had chatted about whether that should be something that we include in the reader. Well, that was at least raised as a potential. We all read, and as I was reviewing the text in preparation for the workshop and for revisions for the coming year, if you turn to page Roman numeral 8, VIII, you will note that we have a statement there about academic culture and etiquette. If you take a look at that briefly, and Jeff has a few more texts if you're looking for one. Is this sufficient? Do we want more?
They're not going to read that.
They'll read that if you tell them.
And tell them it's going to be on the test.
Ooh.
What is appropriate lecture etiquette relative to question and answer period?
Did you just ask? So, what I'm trying to remember what you had given us. I mean, I know you did. And
you sent an email, right? That you then later shared with me.
I sent you an email saying that it might be worth reminding our students as we go into this lecture something we talked about before. I like this statement.
Well, I was thinking this statement was good. Being engaged in public law.
I don't know that I remembered
it. Was
I didn't either until 2 days ago. It's not in where. Okay.
Probably. Well, thank you all. Why would it be? But I think that these people, now that we need to be told, we don't sit and talk to each other during the election.
Yes.
Paying close attention and talking to me are
mutually exclusive.
I don't think they are to be serious.
Right,
they
three
thing,
any three things.
I could only hear the yeah. Is there?
I was echoing Andrew's that they're just watching television. So I think they prefer films or DVDs. So when they're in a lecture, I've noticed that in other situations, that they don't recognize that they're not in a video environment.
We could have our guest speakers announce that they are alive.
That they are alive?
Well, maybe an additional. I had an earlier
suggestion.
Continue to discuss that.
Separate from classroom, as if they, you know, and I think that's sort of a mistake, the way we bifurcate that in a way. You know, it's like the old high school teachers or grade school teachers that told you to be on your best behavior, and they had a guest room, we had a guest speaker, you know, I mean, it's that kind of thing.
But otherwise,
well, except that this first sentence, ever since your classrooms, lecture halls, theaters, libraries, dorms, and athletics, these are all extensions and expressions of the community.
Yeah,
the quality of your experience at Westminster depends on all of us valuing and expressing respect for the community. To that end, students should appreciate the importance of positive community building behaviors, such as
such as not talking.
There's talk in there about our public lectures.
Yeah, well, yeah, the second one. And then it says beyond in being engaged at public performances, that second
right.
one. But the first one actually talks about classes and everything.
If this is slightly beefed up, is it sufficient for the purpose that we want
yes.
to serve?
Yes.
I just remind us to walk through that.
I'm sorry?
We should be reminded
to
walk through this with them. It's best said that first couple of days, because that's not any incriminatory.
It's not correction, it's instruction.
Yeah. Right. Part of the syllabus day.
If you don't, you fail. We could put it on the line with Westminster.
I should not go here, but I think,
yes, sir.
We need this paragraph in some ways because of what they do in the first time. You know, they come in here and have 3 days of block planning games. Then they turn us over and say, okay, now we're going
to talk. That'll be solid.
Not only that, Jim, they have those, tug of war, throwing pies in each other's face, whatever the hell they do, and then they drop them off at our door at 8:30 Monday morning, as if we're an afterthought. Here you are, and these kids are like, they just beat from days of it. It's, the system is askew.
The fact that you're defending us those people.
I just confused to throw pies in my class.
And I'd like to suggest that we use a different font for the whole text. Century Gothic.
Which text are you talking about?
This whole book.
Is that a whole
book?
Yep. No. Uses less ink. Uses less ink.
You will put that to a vote tomorrow.
Do I need a magnifying glass to read? Something?
No, it's better. It's easier to read actually than the time for it.
What? Okay.
Oh, okay. That's dead. Whoops.
Geek.
No,
I am spent and you look spent. I'll see you tomorrow at 8:30 for breakfast.
Okay.
Bacon eggs.
Bacon eggs.
Yeah, right. We're having the same lunch as the president's having tomorrow. Slight step up.
Dorman or Obama?
Dorman. We'll have no control for our new past.
You're saying you have the same lunch as
the president. If you would please, as your assignment, take a look at the articles that have been provided. Let's come to a decision. Please come in with one or two articles that you want to see eliminated.
Dr. Postma already has about 20 of them.
Okay, we will later call you the axe murderers. Questions? Issues? Concerns? Complaints? Other than Century Gothic.
Oh, okay.
Everybody have a good evening.
Complaints, concerns, comments.
Ross had sent sometime during the fall semester, and I thought I would forward it to you just so it didn't get lost buried in my emails. We had talked about revising the title of the third section of the text to the liberal arts in action, or some such text. Do we want to accept that as the title? Do you want to submit suggestions over the next week? I've got to finish up this book in the next 2 weeks.
And if we decide to reshape that section,
okay,
then maybe
that might
be a working title, but maybe something.
Okay, acceptable, pending, thanks Dave, that's good. Pending reshaping. Decisions. These are things that we should confirm that we did yesterday. On the back side of that piece of paper,
add text to the inquiry reader that includes the whole of the catalog description of Westminster plant. Did I understand that properly? Add text to library information literacy assignment. More clearly specifies the amount of writing expected of students. That was Kristen's comment. Add text describing information literacy component of the course to the appropriate material from the reader. Add roast map to table of contents with an asterisk. Those just decision or information point, library homepage will contain this link that will explain and help format citations. I guess this next one maybe should be under the idea column, moving to a different section. Evan's suggestion has to include a paper or other citations for the express purpose of highlighting purposes and structure of the citations. It's got bad text, it's got bad places. Okay, the statement about the learning management system. Does that reflect the, did you get in us, there's a lead that I just gave you, you know, does that reflect the intent of the group? Yes?
Question. A silly one. Is it clear about some
no questions are silly. No, this is inquiry.
I didn't say that.
You haven't heard her ask questions.
Do we teach inquiry in smart classrooms?
Yes.
Okay.
Exclusively.
Exclusively. All right. Thank you.
Anybody want to make any changes to that general approach of policy?
Tim, does that get printed anywhere? That's
no, but I will be asked to defend this.
All right.
And I want to be able to defend what the group has stated. And that's one reason, particularly after some additional comment later in the day, I added this last line. That's what I'm saying. Because I think it shows a willingness to move at the same time. Concern that when we presented appropriately and to the ground. And that's how I would represent us, if that's exactly. Okay. Do some minor review of the section on the inquiry reader on academic culture and etiquette. I'm not sure that it needs much enhancement, but I'll take a look at that. Fall term lunches for inquiry faculty will continue and we'll focus on activities. Jim, there is a statement somewhere about expressing the goals of the first year program. I would get those, but I couldn't find them in the mess last night, but it has not been forgotten.
But more importantly, that's transmitted to the students? Or at least some form of that is transmitted to the students?
It's maybe not in I mean, some of the things about we want to make sure that you stay
right.
are no. going to be transmitted to them.
Right.
But
the academic goals.
Yes.
Yeah.
Might that be on
the web page? The web page that currently exists describes this. The one of the purposes of this is to introduce you to the life of mine. Okay. Items for further reading consideration. David Jim Perkins, we have an update. Looks like October 13th is good for Jim. I will work to schedule it in this room. That shouldn't be a problem. That's the 13th. That's a Wednesday. Evan, is David mad?
Yes, I was going to add this.
Okay.
Squirrels Writers Festival will be October 22nd. David Madden will be here, and I believe as well another frequently anthologized writer of creative nonfiction who is a friend of David Squirrels, but whose name?
He's got friends in literary places.
He's,
but
he's so
drunken sailor will be arriving on campus to provide insights
as,
into...
As usual, we'll have at least one other writer.
So, is November 22nd the day?
October 22nd.
I wonder about that when you said yesterday. Okay, everybody get that. David met October 22nd, so we might anticipate two co-curriculars out of that.
At least
two co-curriculars.
It's all day on it.
David Mott Madden is down in Louisiana. He's bobbing in the Gulf. But bobbing in the Mediterranean is a different. To be named.
Mikey.
Okay. Any other corrections? Things that should be noted explicitly here relative to the recap from yesterday?
Madden is Friday, yeah. October 22nd.
Yes. The whole day.
The whole day.
Is
will be
the one,
accessible.
Not just David Tapper, the whole day is our literary. It's a writer's festival.
During the day.
Workshop, yeah. Participated in reading, question and answer, come and go. It's, yeah.
Because the Friday evening is.
No.
Thank you.
Dorita, I did not get on here the dates of the library, weeks of the library instructions.
Well, three lectures. September 27th, and October 4th.
It's the Friday, 3 o'clock, Friday.
Okay, so library instruction, September 20, September 27th, 27, and October 4th.
Yeah, that week got 3 weeks.
Okay. Patrick, join the group. Yes, I have two additional announcements, one from Kristen and one from Jim Burris.
Well, I don't know if you're familiar with the alternative informative service. I just want to give a pitch for it. It's a wonderful event. The downside is it happens in early December, very late, because it's coincides with the holiday season. But Young Christian Turning Scholars Program puts it on, and it's basically the idea of alternative gifts to buy people for the holidays. And so you can pay $50, and it will help rescue girls from prostitution in Asia. $22 plants 10 trees in the Caribbean and Thailand, that kind of thing. Environmental causes, human determined causes. So it's really a great thing, and I've talked with Carrie Ann, and you know, minimally a student could attend as a co-curricular activity and write about it. If somebody's interested in like service learning for the semester, should be able to work with them on. But service learning for inquiry-based mental service in terms of everything else going on, I bet you've got that carefully. But so this is for your information. I think it really I just picked up some information and it really links to some of the course objectives in terms of ethical living and
okay, thank you. Questions for Kristen? For Dr. Perkins?
Some of you probably don't know, I got a heart attack and had a bypass surgery. But since he's come back from that, his Parkinson's disease has calmed down and he's been able to paint. So we were able to just put on his new paintings. But the woman at the Hoyt did not know Nelson. He hadn't been around there for a while. And she came out to his house and saw his work and said, well, we're going to put it all in. So it is going to be huge, 102 pieces or something like that. And I think it would be a nice opportunity for some of you older people to bring your own to Nelson. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Jim. Thank you, Kristen. 9:15, we have two guests. One is an ongoing colleague. One is a colleague associated with the first year program through the speech class. As you know, the first year program consists not only of Inquiry 111, but also speech and writing. The Fresh Start program and the next chapter is summer reading. So in terms of understanding coordination for the program as a whole, each workshop we have, hopefully, the directors of the speech and writing classes come and chat with us briefly. And that will be Dr. A today, Andrew, for the rest of you. Thank you, Andrew.
So it's, I, for example, give them three very short writing assignments before we even get to these. They're two pages apiece. That's where I do a little diagnostic about their writing, get a sense of their style, where their grammar mistakes are. Believe me, we get the gamut of writers coming in as a first-year student. Some kids know nothing. We are really starting from scratch. I don't know how they got through high school. It's kind of a shock. Others in our classes are remarkably skilled at this age already, and that's a great pleasure. But the types of category of writing assignment we give them basically falls into summarization. They need the art of reading someone else and then capturing what it is that was the essence of that piece in their own style, in their own writing. We teach what paraphrase is versus direct quotation, for example. But summarization is a skill that we want them to work on. Comparison, to take two different readings, and now to find a way to discuss in a larger picture two different voices, two different views, and see if they can reconcile them, if they can point out where the two actually have essential differences that will not reconcile. They should be able to perceive and then articulate what it is about each article that makes it distinct, but also show what they have in common. And finally, argument and analysis papers, where we try to stress, you know, you have to say something, you have to build an argument, you have to lay it out in a way that makes it comprehensible to the reader. So these are the three types of kind of modes of assignment that we give them. It's up, as I said, to the instructor to figure out exactly what assignment that should be. All sections do not hand out the same assignments. So there's a point of term or we generally put them in this order because summarization tends to be a fairly straightforward thing that you jump into right away. And then we come to the idea of them now finding their own voice and their own thinking process to then build their own argument.
Because I think it would be nice to be able to coordinate the assignments that could work basically where you are right. So if there's some way of knowing in October or November, then
well, that will also differ a little from syllabus to syllabus, because we don't all have the same syllabus that we're following schedule, in terms of schedule. If you think of it as the first fourth of the semester is summarization, the second fourth comparison, and then the last half is arguments and analysis, that's essentially the breakdown.
First of all, no matter who's teaching writing, we're going to end up with an argument slash analysis, because that's the most sophisticated writing process and organization and so on.
Yes.
And that includes also research in terms of, are you talking about research process?
Oh, that there is part of it will involve research, just as there's probably a research component going on in inquiry by that time, and that your final projects, whether it's a oral presentation or if it's a paper or an inquiry, whatever you decide, it's involving research at that point.
Andy, I want to preface this by saying I understand this is a collective responsibility, and I'm suggesting that this happen only in this inquiry of the 11th class, or right in the 11th class. But I know from history with our students that number three is the glaring weakness in their writing. And, you know, I give them essay assignments, and they do a wonderful job at number one. You know, they can summarize, but point three is where they're deficient. And I don't know whether, we can do anything to beef up that section of the course or what, but that seems to me to be.
Can I jump in there?
Yes.
I've taught at a college where also students have to take two semesters of writing, and the second semester was argument. Is, first of all, the prime stomping ground for plagiarism. And I have found it's very, very difficult to teach create content in a writing class, but then you have no time to or very little time to discuss the basics of writing that are essential in order to argue coherently. And so it's a real dilemma, but I guess my conclusion has been that beyond introducing them to what argument is and that it is not distant else, that seems to me the level of thinking and writing toward which their majors will
and the problem, Jim, is that we have, as Andrew said, we have such a wide variety of students that you really have to try to accommodate the class for the first half of the semester to make sure that they're writing complete sentences. So the last 2 years that I've taught with the honors of writing class, I've worked almost exclusively on argument analysis. But oh, surprise, surprise. These kids already can write pretty well when they come to school.
Right.
So you don't have to work with a lot of any of the other issues there.
No, I understand. That's why I said it's a collective response.
Right.
Yeah.
Also, the writing, you're getting, I recognize the point, you have a great diversity of writers. When we're teaching, I taught in, I think it's the first time I taught in person section, and I had a bunch of very, very music. And that really undermined a lot of what I was trying to do. So people who are teaching courses with a speech component, who have the best writers, they're teaching a different course than the course that people who are teaching with writing sections. And I think that there has to be much more, with this group, the inquiry course has to be much, much more writing intensive. And it doesn't make sense to sort of go in different directions with the writing component of the course and content. You find some way to sort of join hands here on common writing assignments or working on common style.
So you say for writing sections,
right,
that they should have a stronger focus on writing than...
Well, there should be some much more integrated communication between writing sections, inquiry sections, particularly for the students who are writing sections.
Andrew, just following on the last two comments, it seems that is there some way to link? I know that they have the same courses, right? I mean, the same group that's in the inquiry group is in the writing or the speech section. Do the writing...
They're not all in the same section.
They're not all in the same
section.
But they're all in writing. They're all in
writing.
They're not... It's not like a cluster.
No.
It's not the cluster model.
Right.
It's not out there.
Just, okay. Because what I was wondering, do the writing to get the content, I mean, we're essentially providing the content in inquiry. I mean, could the writing instructors use the inquiry syllabuses? Would it help the writing instructors to give them the inquiry syllabuses so that they would know they could use that? And is there a way to cluster it? Maybe not this year, but in the future?
I think that's been tried in the past.
That was the original thought when inquiry was before. And that it was impossible for the rest of our system.
Your point is probably more relevant to what they're saying.
I don't think so.
Well, I was just going to say that a couple of things. I think, Evan, your point about teaching argument and writing technique, you're right. It's really hard to do that in one course. But one thing that I think I've seen, relevant to what you're saying, I do a writing workshop in my writing sessions of inquiry. I do a day or two, depending on what they need. We cancel readings. I make them bring a draft. And I have a very specific handout I give them, but it seems to help. The problem, Andrew, like you're saying, is that there's such a range, and some of the students will then say in evaluations, I don't need to work on grammar, that was a waste of my time, but most of them will say, this was helpful. And another thing is, relevant to the library instruction, I think that argument has so much to do, and I'm thinking from what you said, about the way they engage with sources in college. They were not taught in high school to engage critically with sources. They were taught to lock them into a paper and summarize them. And it's useful for us to start with summary because they still don't summarize well. But I think that maybe as inquiry instructors, we can really emphasize that
about capacity. You have a voice here. We want to know what you think about what these sources say. So I think that helps with that.
You see, you know, I find myself as I don't know who your plans are going to. I'm sorry, Alice. No matter how noble your plans are in teach inquiry in terms of introducing students to the noble, to the liberal arts, what I find myself just dissolving to is just getting on their backs without writing. You know, my course is essentially focuses on, you know, can you put an argument together? And, you know, so I'm spending most of my instructional time in class trying to get them to communicate on paper. And then I have, and then sort of, as I said, am I just sort of writing an inquiry two ships passing in the night here? Or is there some way we could reinforce each other's messages? Because that almost is exclusively my message in these courses as writing.
Well, I think there's always been a desire to make it mutually reinforcing. But Ross, were you going to?
Well, I'm just really making a similar point to what Christiane said, and it kind of addresses Alice too. I think your next item is research on your PowerPoint. Is that?
No.
Oh, okay. Well, if it were, I mean, it could very well be. Because I think, while we can look at the different types of assignments, as Christiane mentioned, I think from the get-go, we're working with them on research techniques. Doing research, but also then writing a research-based, incorporating information in their paper. So to that extent, you don't have to wait until assignment three to get instruction that's going to be helpful in the work.
Although I have to say, I do not stress research as an area in writing. I make my inquiry class about research. I do not make writing about research. I make writing about writing.
But incorporating information.
Sure.
The
research is going out and finding it and
I guess,
sorting
I guess,
through it.
Yeah, the other point I want to make was to suggest that we all do just what Alan said, that we teach writing in our inquiry courses, because I think we've learned that it's a fallacy. I mean, even in English courses, we have English majors who like to, you know, who are not afraid of writing, but they always need to learn about writing in every single course. So you never teach them, they're done with it. So what I hear some people suggesting is that writing bear a little more of the load in equipping students to do college writing. That's one thing the writing course does, but I think we have to do that in every single course that,
sure.
that those students
and,
take.
And everyone has a comment about that this topic is in.
Well, I mean, and there's so much room to do that too, because if you collect any writing from them, you realize that they're not making paragraphs, they don't have topic sentences, they don't have flow, there's no, I mean, it just goes on and on and on. There's a lot nobody's thinking about that.
Well, let me just finish the component list and get back to the questions, because I don't want to get hung up on that one. We do a certain amount of grammar review and testing, and I particularly test grammar because I'm exasperated with their sloppy use of the language. And I have daily grammar reading assignments in the Prentice Hall reference guidance they get in their first year.
Every student gets that book in the inquiry packet. So all students, including those who are taking speech in the fall, have that book.
And in any course you teach, inquiry, psych, history, philosophy, you can send it back to that book.
We'd also review how to structure a paper. This was getting to what some of you have been saying about knowing how to do an introduction and a conclusion and body paragraphs and topic sentences and what a thesis statement is. Where you put the thesis statement. Believe me, we are going over it and over it and over it, and even though they end up semesters later in your classes and still do not implement these things, our efforts were made in that first semester to make them just get a basic template down. Just to get a template down is hard. They resisted. They
start writing outside of it. So we feel the pain that you feel when we get our own papers from students beyond writing 111 when they're not doing their job. I had a kid, he took four classes from me. The first class was writing 111. His fourth class, he still could not put the paper together. And I said, who is your writing teacher? I'm so sorry. So I worked and worked with that kid, and nothing stayed. And then the last of the major components is the introduction of how to cite. Citation, and we use the standard MLA, which is what is presented in here. We also tell them that once you get into your specialization, once you get into your major department will be telling you which citation format to use. But everyone should be able to start with basic modern language association style, and then you can depart from that. So we don't say it's MLA until you graduate. We say it's MLA at the beginning, and then move into your major format. So these are the essential components of a writing 111 class. Now, to get back to your comments, David.
I'd just like to say for those who have been around that long, we have argued about this for 15, 18 years because it's a perennial problem.
Right.
But I found as I've watched it that it's not always a defect of writing skills. And I'd like to talk about, the gathering of data, reading and watching, thinking about the material and then writing. So I've often found the defect is in the thinking section. Well, if they haven't read the article, then they can't think about it. So I can beat them over the head with the technique, but if they're not doing it, they're not getting the content now. So I don't know how we address that, but I know a lot of writing instructors are very frustrated, not just in English, but across the board, because of me, like you did with that guy 4 years in a row. And so, there may be some ways we can go after things. One, get them to read it. Two, get them to think about it. And because to me, whether you do a speech or a writing assignment, it's the same thing. It's nice in the speech because the details of their thinking are evident to the entire class. If we address all of those things, and that goes to what we're reading. If they can't understand what they're reading, then they can't talk about it.
And those are the kids you're going to have that first semester. That's the SAT looker. You've always put the lowest, whatever the cutoff point is, all those low verbal SAT kids get writing in the fall. The SAT verbal exam is not an exam about writing. It's about reading comprehension, vocabulary, and thought. And so that's the problem now when you're having with those kids as much as anything else. They're not processing with the thought as well as having
the thought. But I understand what you're saying, but I think writing is a way of discovering what you're thinking. And, I don't completely buy the argument that they're entirely pathless. I think it's they're not practiced in getting their ideas down, listing them, organizing them, and then constructing arguments. So, I think that writing, what you're setting up a situation which is, it's not remedial, how do you get kids to think? If you get kids to write, then you train them.
I agree with David in part that fuzzy writing reflects fuzzy thinking, and not just fuzzy thinking, but, and maybe fuzzy thinking is an it, but rather a lack of investment in thinking.
Yeah, the way one clears one's thoughts is to organize it on the device in front of you, and organize it and emulate stuff like that. That's how you defuzzify your thinking.
And that takes investment, right. In the sense. So part of our challenge is to motivate them to invest in this difficult, mind-numbing, blood-draining experience we call writing,
But there's a loop there.
Except if we wait for some 5 minutes to just share the syllabi and things on.
various writing structures.
So I could get an idea of what you guys are working on, and then I would know that what I'm assigning is who's
who. Maybe what you might do, Al, for folks who are interested in that type of linkage would be to get from the students, who's your writing instructor? And then an email to each of those instructors will likely produce syllabi from each of them that then you could, so rather than, so if you have, you know, on your first day, you get all this personal information on a note card, maybe that's what I do, and then make